I'd like to open the February 4th, 2015 meeting of the Northampton License Commission. I'm Commissioner William Rosen. This is Commissioner Brian Campidelli. The meeting is being audio and video recorded. At this time, I'd ask for public comment on any items not on the agenda or any items on the agenda unless you plan to speak later. Seeing none, I'll move down to the agenda. What I'd like to do, in the interest of time, since we have such a crowd, we have violation hearings which take a lengthy amount of time, I'd like to let the building commissioner report briefly first, the fire department report briefly on some inspections we had done. And then I'd like to take item number 11, the Northampton St. Patrick's Committee, very briefly. I know that these things will go very short. They can get out of here in the interest of efficiency and not making them wait around for what will be much more lengthy agenda items. I'd like to do that. The Forbes Library Trustees, you'll see on your agenda, they're not present today, so we'll take that at the end. So at this time, I'd like to move to item number 7, final report from Building Commissioner for premises with liquor licenses for 2015. Captain Terrence, from the fire department. Could you identify yourself for the record? Actually, no, not for the record.
Okay. Captain Larry Theron from the fire department. Larry Theron. So,
this is.
The building commissioner can't be here. He is actually going to one of the outstanding inspections to see if we can get that one squared away. I just met with him before coming up here. At this point, we have 9 outstanding liquor license holders that still have violations. Of those, one is in the midst of some work at their building, so they're having some contractor issues. The building commissioner was under the impression that that work will be done in a timely manner, so he was comfortable with that one being done quickly. 6 other ones have minor issues, very minor issues. They just have not corrected them yet. And then there's 2 other ones that have several more involved issues that may become problematic beyond another 30-day extension. The building commissioner and I were both under the agreement that we would go for one more 30-day extension, but at the end of that, these things really should be corrected. I can talk about them in more detail, but that's kind of the gist of where we're at for this point.
I don't know, you need to let us know now, unless the 30 days runs out, you have to come back. That's what you would.
I think what we'll do is the building commissioner will sign off on another 30-day extension. We get about halfway through that, we can update through Cynthia to let you know where we're at with everybody. And if the two that we think may be issues, because there's a much longer list of more involved corrections to be made, if they're going to be problematic, we can let you know at that point.
Okay. But everyone else checked out.
Yes, exactly. I mean, obviously the vast majority, given the number that we have in the city, are done, complete, and fine. It's these last right. 9 that we're down to now.
Okay.
And it may be down to less than that. Lou's going to check on one right now. If you guys have any questions on any of these? Okay.
So we hope you don't have to come back next
time. I hope I don't have to come back next time, too.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay, let me move to agenda item number 11, application for short-term all alcohol, Greater Northampton St. Patrick's Committee. Somebody here from the St. Patty's Day Committee. Chris. We're taking you out of order.
Thank you, sir.
So you can get out of here.
Thank you.
Not have to wait through the crowd here. So if you could just identify yourself for the record.
Chris Powers, Northampton St. Pat's Association.
And tell us.
We have a one-day liquor license application in for our annual St. Patrick's Banquet to honor our honorees this year, Kay Kowalski and Francis Whalen, in the city at the St. John Cantius Parish Hall on Holly Street. We are lacking one piece of information. The diocese from Springfield, because the weather did not send over the certificate of insurance. They promised it would be in our hand tomorrow. And Sean Sullivan was supposed to be here. I was representing him. He's stuck in Hamley.
All right.
Evening event. If you have any questions about it, if you want me to.
I'll make sure it's okay. I'll make sure make a motion then that we approve the short-term alcohol license for the St. Patrick's Day Committee.
Pending insurance.
I'll have that for the city council.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. What a wonderful evening.
Sure. Okay, we'll go back to the agenda item number 5 now, this time.
No.
This is a violation hearing for 7 restaurants which were the subject of a compliance check by the Northampton Police Department. We have the 7 listed here on the agenda. At this time, I'd like to ask the police department to tell us what happened and what the violations they are alleging were.
Hello. Hi. My name is Jody Casper. I'm the captain of operations with the Northampton Police Department. I'll just provide you with an overview of what happened on the night of the compliance check, and then we have several officers here who can talk more in detail if there's further questions. On December 26th, between 4:30 p.m. and 10:30 p.m., officers with our department, in collaboration with the Northampton Prevention Coalition, conducted a citywide alcohol compliance check using underage individuals as per NPD's and the ABCC's operational policy and procedure. There are 108 licensed establishments in the city. 10 were closed at the time of the check, so a total of 98 establishments were checked. And of these, 7 served underage individuals in violation of CMR 2.05, permitting an illegality on the licensed premise, to wit, MGL 138, section 34, sale or delivery of an alcoholic beverage to a person under 21 years of age, no request for ID. The 7 businesses are India House. They actually had 2 violations that night, Viva Fresh Pasta, 2 counts, Blue Bonnet, these are all now 1 count, Roberto's, Siam Square, Sierra Grill, and Le Bras Bistro and Market. The officer who oversaw the event was actually Detective Sergeant Caputo. He's not present tonight, he's away at training, and Officers Anthony Sadalato and Officer Brendan McKinney, who are both here. I can go over the individual violations for each restaurant. Is that what you prefer now? I can give you 2 sentences on each so you have a general idea of what happened.
Yeah, if you could summarize. We're
sure.
Familiar with the procedures that you follow and
absolutely.
What often happens in these cases. If there's anything out of the ordinary that you'd like to highlight, that would be fine.
Nothing too out of the ordinary. At India House, 2 operatives went in at 9 o'clock. They were served a Taj Mahal beer and an Old Monk beer that cost $13.80. They have a receipt for that. Viva Fresh Pasta, there were 2 counts. Operatives went in at 6:30. They were both served draft beers with a total of $7.49. Blue Bonnet, single operative, went in at 8:46 and was served a hard cider for $4.55. Roberto's Restaurant, operative went in at 8:25 and was served a Corona beer that cost $4. Siam Square, operative entered at 6:53 and was served a Sam Adams Light bottled beer for $4.01. Sierra Grill, operative entered at 7:37 and was served a bottled beer with the word blue in the name, the operative was not sure, for $8. And finally, at Le Bras Bistro and Market, operative entered at 8:46 and was served a bottled porter-style beer that cost $6.42. The summation of all the compliance violations that we had that night.
And I assume, according to your procedures, that none of these underage people were carrying IDs and that they weren't asked for IDs in any instance, or?
That is accurate. Yep, they provided IDs when they arrived. We took them and moved them from them and held them throughout the compliance check. And we took all their money into their pockets, and then we provided them with money from our officers.
Okay, so there was no one who was asked for an ID and then saying, I don't have one, was still
That's
served.
That's correct. Okay.
Do you have any questions for Captain Casper?
I mean, not on the overview at all. I mean, as we go through, I'm sure.
All right. Okay. Is anything else to add, Captain, on this matter? Okay.
That's it for me for now.
Okay. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to hear from the licensees in response to the department's allegations in this case. Let me go at the request of one of the applicants. I'm going to leave that till the end. Let me just start then with the allegation against India House. Is there somebody here who would like to answer this charge? Sir, could you just identify yourself?
Yes, sir. My name is Om Prakash Kanojia. I'm the owner of India House Restaurant. And on that day, we had some unexpectedly what had happened. We have three people in the kitchen, two cooks and one dishwasher didn't show up, and two people on the floor didn't show up. And we have all the procedure to always check all the things. We have four of us have on our cell phone, we have the app to check the IDs and all that thing. But on that day, because of the short of the help, my son who went in the kitchen filling up the two cooks, myself was managing the floor and washing the dishes and all that. So one of the person we trained to just serve the drinks when we take the order, because we take the orders, and then we have trained few people to serve the drinks. And the person in our restaurant, when the guest comes in and sit down, we serve them crackers and the water pitcher. When this person who was trained to serve the drinks is went to give the water, because he is not allowed to take the orders for anything, neither the food, neither the drinks. But these two people, when they came in, they asked him that, can we have the drinks, Taj Mahal and Old Monk? And he came and he told my wife that they want the drink, because we were so shambled and so stressed out at that time. She didn't look at it and she said, okay, you can go ahead and serve it. And that thing, it happens, sir, and we are in the business, you know, that we are for 30 years, and this is the first time it happened with us. We have taken all the precautions and all these things, but on that day, because we are slammed with the business, we are so busy, so much takeouts, we have it, big takeouts and all these things, the kitchen is shambled because of the short of the help, unexpected. These people, they were not, they were scheduled to work, but they didn't show up, you know. So we were not prepared for that, and that is the one reason that thing, it slipped from us.
So the underage person was in fact served at your
restaurant.
Yes, sir. Due to the circumstances you described.
Due to the circumstances.
And it's Mr. Kanojia?
Yes, yes.
Do you have any questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Would you like to hear from all of them and vote on the whole package at the end? Okay, I agree. The next one on the list here would be Bistro Le Gras. Ms. Martinez.
Hello.
Just identify yourself for the reporter.
Elizabeth Martinez, I'm owner and manager of Bistro Le Gras.
So you've heard the NPD's account, and do you have anything you want to tell us about the incident?
No, not especially. I mean, it was the end of a busy holiday season. I'm sure that's what everyone's going to say. It's a hard time, but I'll be honest, a mistake was made, and we're certainly not going to do it. You know, we've never had any infractions or had the people who work for us. And it was various reasons this one happened.
What policies do you have in place right now?
We card anyone who looks, we should be carding anyone who looks under 30. I mean, we don't have we don't card at the door or anything. We don't have a lot of, you know, more restaurants than a bar. It was a set of unfortunate incidents that led to a bad night, and we were off our game.
I think you addressed this when you were into for the conversion of your license, but are all of your staff currently, who are now serving customers, alcohol tips or serve safe training?
Yes, they are. And again, we have very strict rules on carding and all the time on making sure they're carding. We are, I'd say it's more often for us, we get someone who comes in with their parents who's 20 who says they should be able to drink, which of course we don't allow, but we're always carding, and this was just just a mistake that was made after a hard
time. You're right next to the college, so.
Yeah, we're very, very strict about it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is Viva Fresh Pasta. Is there somebody here? Could you identify yourself?
Yes, I'm Christine Buchholz. I'm co-owner of Viva Fresh Pasta. And it was a very busy night. I was on the floor. I'm the manager. And our policy is a written policy that everyone gets carded. They don't have gray hair, they're carded. And I don't even remember having to not serve somebody. I mean, the servers are usually on the ball. And the server who ended up, I was seating people. I did not seat that table of the two young people who we sent in. Somebody, because I was downstairs in our dining room, somebody else sat them. It was very busy. And the server who did serve them, there would be, this person has waited tables for over 20 years and has served and has, as far as I know, may have certification. She has not responded to my theories about that. We did let her go that evening, or the day after, next day when the policeman came in, because we have a zero tolerance for that. And it is something that we talk about all the time in our pre-meal discussions, and for being in business as long as we have, so 30 years as well in town, and we have never had any infraction or an issue with this, and we don't have people coming in and getting drunk, and we don't serve underage people, the same situation with families wanting their kid to have a drink on graduation and being really mad that we won't let them, but we don't. It's upsetting, and it happened, and the service no longer with us. If you take into consideration that fact that we don't have an issue, I've never had an issue.
So you don't know the person you fired was Christy Peterson?
I do know, yeah. I don't, she may have certification herself.
So you don't know whether your employees, as a matter of course, are required to get tips or serve safe training when they come to serve alcoholic beverages?
It's a voluntary, it's voluntary in Massachusetts. And we do have written policies which we give to the employee when they start to work, which states that you may not, you know, all the rules of service and what's allowed and what's not.
But you don't ask them to, in turn, go for the training?
We haven't. I am certified, and I was certified in 95, and I've recently been recertified, and both of my managers are certified.
Any questions from this conference?
No. I just was concerned about the color. I wanted to follow the policy.
Well, no, don't ask me to ask.
No, I know. It's just that it doesn't.
I
don't have any questions for you now.
Well, it's an open meeting. He was just expressing concern about the person you fired, but he then said that it's none of our business. So that's
well, we have a zero tolerance for that in other activities that might happen.
Is that a written policy? I mean,
yes,
since
it is.
We're going to
yes,
talk about
it? Is.
It? Okay,
yes,
so
it.
Also in that written policy is not to serve and to card everybody that doesn't have gray hair?
That's correct.
It is. Okay. You don't have a copy of that policy, mm-hmm. do you? Great.
And subsequent to that incident, I went through and had everybody read, you know.
So even though it's voluntary, do you think they have a session that we got to have some of those people on the ground if you like to make sure?
To get certified?
Sure.
Sure. Statements of employees' understanding of the alcohol policies that everybody has had to sign and has signed again, went through this, and did retraining with the staff, written quizzes. So that's something that I felt was already clear was clearer.
Establishment is Bhuvan Thayer.
Hello.
Identify yourself for the record,
please. Sure. My name is James Greco, and I'm the owner of Bhuvan Thayer.
So, Mr. Greco, you heard the NPD's report.
Yes.
Would you like to say in response to the allegation?
Yes. I would like to say that we at the Bhuvan take the responsibility of serving alcohol very seriously and serving alcohol. And we're embarrassed about the situation and upset about it. And we are taking action by training. All our bartenders are TIPS certified, except Lisa, who was the bartender on duty that night. And she is going to be TIPS certified. She signed up for the course this past Monday, but it got canceled due to the snowstorm. In fact, I was going to go too, because I'm TIPS certified. But I haven't had a few years, so I thought I'd get recertified. And I'm going to, in the next coming months, do some more certifying. Some of the servers, the waitresses and waiters that are on the floor, some are not TIPS certified. But some are, but the ones that aren't, I'm going to make sure they get the TIPS certified. And so that'll make it across the board. But all our bartenders at this time, except Lisa, she will be, as of March 2nd, will be TIPS certified. So I take that action to rectify the situation. And Lisa, she's a very conscientious worker, and I know with this training that she can be very good bartender, and she's very conscientious about carding people. You know, in the past, she's been with us for, I think, about a couple years now, and as part-time bartender, and she's been very conscientious about this issue with the banquets also, so you really have to be carding a lot out there when the younger kids come in, and they really have to card a lot. So it was a mistake on this night. You know, she'll admit that she should have carded this person, and we're going to take the action of certifying people.
So she'll be certain this deed?
Yes, most definitely.
Great. Okay. Any questions? Anything else to add?
No.
Okay. The next would be Siam Square. Is there somebody here from Siam Square? Hi. Just identify yourself. Tell her.
Yes, I'm a veteran of Siam Square. I accept that it's my fault.
It's very difficult. I'm having a hard time understanding.
Just say your name clearly for.
Chetamat.
How do you spell it?
Chetamat. Yes, I accept that it's my fault and we're going to check the ID of my customer. When the incident happened, I had a lot of drinks to go and things to do at the same time. And my coworker is the new server who doesn't know much about the job. I will in rush to give this customer a service and serve alcohol without shaking and heading. Normally, manager at Siam Square strictly remind every server about the shaking ID of minors and keeps following the serving alcohol regulations. Yeah, and I feel very guilty and want to do it again. I will be careful and following the server's alcohol regulations.
So you were the actual person served, and the manager at the time was, sorry, I'm not going to pronounce this right, Mr. Dekhanakhan? How was that? No, the other, manager in charge.
Yeah, Chawali.
Chawali?
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Chawali or Mr.?
Chawali, Dekhanakhan, and the manager at the time.
So you're the manager or the owner of the business?
No, just the manager.
The manager, okay. And you've heard us talk about the tips and serve safe training. Do you have that? You do? Okay. And do you also serve?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any questions? No. Okay. Okay, so if there's anything else you'd like to add, not, thank you. Thank you. I have the names here on the police report. They're all here. Okay, the next would be Sierra Grill. Mr. O'Brien.
Yep, O'Brien Tomlin, owner and manager of the Sierra Grill. So, very busy holiday weekend. I guess you could call on to that everybody was pretty much slammed and, difficult time. I was about 2 feet away from the incident when it happened. I had two bartenders on. One typically takes the tables out in front. It was Ashley's been hired for about a month, maybe a little bit more, but this was really the first sort of too deep at the bar, moving people from the bar to tables. So we're a restaurant primarily. There's only 30 plus seats in the bar. Policy is when you go over to someone, they get a drink menu and they get a glass of water in front of them. I was reaching over to my right to go get it. She had already gotten to the young woman with it. I think one of the big things that might happen in Ashley's brain, and she's very aware of our policy to card anyone under 40 is what I say, because it's just impossible to really tell, and it's not that big of a deal to get carded for alcohol these days, is that the young woman went on the bottle list and went and ordered probably the darkest and the slowest moving bottle of dark Belgian beer we had, which is a Chimay Blue. It's a Trappist beer. And I think that must have sort of triggered something in her mind where it wasn't a Corona, it wasn't the tip. I mean, I would imagine we probably had a good solid six or so things that I've been privy to and seen them happen. And not that, afterwards is when you go like, oh, wait a minute, that's probably what just happened there. That's why they left abruptly. That's why, when we asked them for ID, they just turned and left. So I think that might have triggered something in her head. And it was her first night, the person behind the bar handles all that, has some service bar tickets. And I was almost going to kind of step in because she seemed a little bit overwhelmed, but I believe in not really micromanaging and letting people kind of find their way. Yes, she does still work for me as well. You know, when she went right away, when she said, oh, the person, you know, paid for the beer, but then her friend wasn't showing, and she just left it. And we were all standing there kind of going, that's weird. And I was like, yes. In the back of my head was like, oh, I've seen this before. And then at 10:30, when the officers came in, I knew right away. I impressed upon them the fact that we've definitely been open for over 8 years, and nothing like this has ever happened. My full staff is TIP certified, except Ashley. She was away on the last class, this last one, and then this one that she was scheduled for got canceled because of the snow, but she was already scheduled before the incident to do it, but was not going to be in town at the time of the class. Like I said, my full floor staff, my bartenders, everybody's always been certified. I believe in it. I pay for it to have people do it, and likewise, I pay for my kitchen staff to be certified as well for all the training they need to do. The policy's in effect. We're not really implementing anything else. It's my staff cards. Everybody, I get a lot of, I don't want to say complaints from people, but I definitely get feedback from people saying that, you know, and then the whole serve my kid thing is ever present, but that just is ridiculous, and that gets thrown out the window. But definitely, you know, we have people who are, you know, in the you know, late to mid 30s who don't have a valid ID with them, have done whatever, and I always offer a soft drink and say, I'm sorry, if you go get it, I'll take care of your next one on me. But you know, when people have left and come back, they've driven 10 minutes, but I certainly, it always comes to me, I get the ID if there's an issue with anything. And 90% of the time it's denied, you know, due to whatever reason, you know, but certainly someone always gets asked, and if someone doesn't have an ID, they're never gonna get served. So, and you know, it was a busy night, but I don't really, you know, we do our jobs so much all the time, and we're closed for 2 days, you walk back into it, and it's all of a sudden someone turns the light on, and you've got everybody and their parents trying to get tables for six, and you know, it's a crazy time. That's no excuse. I believe in it, and I ran a bar in Amherst for years, and it's always it's a big responsibility that we're given here, you know, and but that's about it.
And so Miss Barry is staying on, and she'll be.
Yeah, she's here as well. She's
so that's okay. We don't need to, unless she wants to speak up, but we don't.
The only thing that she might say is that she was impressed when she started that week. I was very clear about our policy, and it was not, and you know, everybody knows it, so, and I think we have a reputation for that too, that it's not a, and then, you know, in all honesty, I think there's some nights when town's jamming, and we definitely have some empty seats at the bar, because we don't really attract the, you know, 3 23-year-olds, and then the 20-year-old younger brother to come in, you know, stuff like that, so, but, you know, I'm not complaining. I still think it should be 18 for beer and wine while we're in a public forum. Because after dealing in Amherst with people for years and years, I feel like you have people that consume alcohol and so in a non-social situation, and they just do whatever they want, and then someone hands them a ticket when they're 21 and they get to do what they've been doing for the last 4 years and without any social consequences. And unfortunately, sometimes we get the brunt of it. Not so much now in Northampton, but in Amherst, I had to deal with that for years, so, and that's unfortunate. But
if we were only legislators.
Yeah, sure. Well, I mean, honestly, when you were you turned 18, you could probably buy a beer, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And when I turned 18, District of Columbia was still 18, so. Yeah. But in any event, you guys need anything else from us, or?
Brian, do you have questions? Okay, thank you, Mr.
Sure.
Okay, last up is Roberto's. I understand Roberto's is represented by counsel, Mr. McCarthy.
Well, all us Nicks are alike.
McGuire, I'm sorry.
My actual name is McGuire.
I'm sorry.
McCarthy.
I apologize, guys.
That's all right. All the same. So. What I am about to tell you two guys, after I say it, you'll probably look at me and think I have three heads. But bear me up. When I first got a call from Mo McGinnis, who was the owner of Roberto's, and I think it was on December 27th, Mo was upset because she had just looked at the surveillance videotapes, which showed a huge, burly, hulking hulk of a man coming in with the notice of violation, standing next to a young-looking, clean-cut, close-shaved police officer. And you should have pictures, and I'd like to know if you do.
Yes, we do.
Good. So the gist is, she thought that was unfair because Jen Dorado, the bar manager, had served him because she thought he looked 35, not his stated age of 20. So my first reaction to Mo, was to say, I think it's unfair too, but so what? Life is unfair. Lots of things that happen to people are unfair. And I figured, well, it's no consequence. It's a simple question of law, which actually is the case. Should criminal proceedings be brought against somebody who serves to a minor? It is purely black and white. The question is, was the person served?
This is not a criminal proceeding.
I know. No, I understand that. I'm making a contrast specifically because there is a huge difference between a criminal proceeding. Because in the context of a criminal proceeding, what I am about to present to you makes no difference whatsoever. It's black and white. Is the person underage? Were they served? In the story, it doesn't matter. But ironically, and this is the part where you'll probably think I have three heads, it does mean everything in this particular case. Because in license suspension proceedings, a license revocation or suspension cannot stand unless there is strict compliance with the guidelines that have been adopted by Northampton. And even in cases where they haven't adopted a guideline, the ABCC essentially has the same guidelines. So I have enclosed two cases, one an appellate case and the other a Superior Court judgment, which stands for the proposition that you cannot successfully suspend a license in a sting operation that is not performed in accordance with the guidelines. And the reason behind this is about fairness. So the most important of these guidelines is guideline number B, which says that in a sting operation, thou shalt not use any operative unless they reasonably look their age. That's big. So that's really a question. You look at the picture, you tell me. And then the second directive that was violated in this sting was thou shalt make sure that the underage operative leaves his beer on the bar. And in this case, the rotund bearded man actually, when nobody was looking, put the beer to his side and walked about the 8 feet to the front door and left. There are two distinct guidelines that were violated in this instance. And based upon the law, which I was surprised to learn, the law is absolutely clear. If you are convinced that that man does not reasonably look 20 years old, I ask and urge you to not impose or not find Roberto's in violation. Because to do so would be not in accordance with settled law. Thank you.
Yes, I read your memo beforehand and it was provided to all of us here. I'm looking for, here it is, in our packet here, but are the pictures in question of the underage person that came in with the officer. So this is from your surveillance video?
No. That one there was provided by the Northampton Police Department.
Right.
In response to a Freedom of Information request from myself, if I'm looking at, can I approach?
Yeah.
I just got to make sure I'm doing the right one.
These two things were in our packet.
Yes, this is a Northampton Police Department. As part of their protocol, they have to take a photograph of the operative. Northampton PD.
Okay, and this is
surveillance video.
This is from the Roberta.
Yep, that's right. We got a lot more to.
Do you have any questions right now for Attorney McGuire?
He actually walked out of the restaurant with the beer.
I can show you pictures.
Yeah.
So.
I believe you. I just.
Yeah.
You said he made his way towards the door. I didn't know if he exited the building. That's
all. Oh, yeah.
Really?
Had the beer right there. And Jen Tirado, who will testify later, was standing right in front of him while he was seated next to a very young-looking girl. Kind of a stunning contrast. And she ordered the glass of water. And they appeared as a couple, kind of an odd couple, if you will. And the bearded guy waited until Jen was engaged with another server, I believe. And then just, boom. And it's less than 10 feet from where he was sitting in the stool to the glass door.
Is this a bottle or a glass?
Bottle of Corona.
Do you know what happened to the bottle?
I imagine it's went into the police cruiser.
Did he get arrested for walking outside with an open container?
By the police?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Was anybody else of the establishments that we've already heard from here? Was anybody else in violation of serving a drink to this particular?
Can person? I respond? Can I use the blackboard? Is that okay?
That's like a cork board, actually.
Well, I know, but it flips. I hope. So, because there's an eraser there in chalk.
If it's necessary. If you feel it's necessary.
Yeah, I think it would be very helpful if I can do it.
Okay.
I'm not very mechanically gifted.
Pink?
What's your while he's doing that, Mr. Greco?
Yes.
You say that this individual was
yes.
also
yes.
the one who purchased.
Yeah. Now, Lisa, here's the bartender. I wasn't there at the time.
Thank you.
But she did say he did look older.
Was
you know.
Do you remember if the beer or whatever his order was left on the bar?
He asked for a glass and he poured it into a glass.
I'm sorry, you're Lisa Kelly?
That would be
D.
Great.
Lisa.
Sorry?
D.
Lisa D, I'm sorry. So, I'm sorry, repeat that then again, Lisa D.
He asked for a glass and he poured it into the glass and then disappeared.
Did he
left it on the
bar. He did leave it on the bar.
Okay, here. I kind of know these facts, so. They're also contained in a police report. So here it goes. This is police department time.
Right.
Enters.
We do have a police report, Mr. McGuire.
Yeah. Well, this is going to answer your question.
Okay.
Enters Roberto's. This is the operative, the bearded guy. His operative code name is DM. So he enters Roberto's, DM. Alone. No, I'm sorry, with the young girl.
Right.
He exits, we don't know exactly what time, but he surfaces again at 8:47 alone at Blue Bonnet. And he is served hard cider, one. Over here, one Corona. And then, 9 o'clock or 9:02, I think, he's at the India House with a girl. And at there, he served two draft beers. Not two. One for each. One beer apiece. So that's what happened. So you can see, allowing for travel time, DM, and of course, order in being in the establishment. He goes from Roberto's directly to Bluebonnet, directly to the India House. He was not carded at any of those establishments. There were 8 operatives used in this sting, 7 violations found. Of the 7 violations, he was involved in 3, close to 50%. Pretty high batting average.
Move that back so
sure.
Mr. Contrada at least can see what's going on.
How many operatives did you say?
8.
And there were 7 places? So to your point, you're saying that, you know, why not use a different operative for each one?
No.
I get it. You're 50% of the time, but
he was involved. There were 7 violations found. So even though 8 operatives were going about, he was served 3 out of the 7 violations found.
I guess.
And he was served back to back to back within roughly a half hour.
Thank you, Mr.
McGuire. Oh, you're welcome.
I'd like to get the Captain Casper to come up again, but just before I do, I'd just like to ask again, Ms. D, if you could just stand up again. And so this person came in, you looked at him, and you thought he was looked over 30?
Oh, I thought he was over 30, for sure. I have a 27-year-old daughter, and I thought he looked way older than her.
Okay. And
so my wife looked at it from back in, right from the there, because he was sitting to the window, and our serving station is there, you can say, at the most, like 8 feet.
Yep.
She looked at from there, she said, looks big guy and all that, okay, go serve, and that's it.
But he was, in your case, he was accompanied by a woman.
By a woman, yeah.
Yeah. Who?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because he didn't look at the girls, because the girl, he was sitting the facing to her.
Yeah.
So she looked at him, and she said, okay.
So he came in with somebody who was younger looking. And
yeah.
But she
can only see a back of her.
Okay. What I'd like to, Captain Casper, we've heard from all the licensees, and what I'd like you to do is, if there's anything you have to comment on any of the things not related to Attorney McGuire's contention that you did not comply with the terms with the guidelines here in that matter, but on any of the others not involving this particular underage operative, is there anything you'd like to talk to, speak to about anything you heard from the other licensees here? Any comment you have on anything they said?
The only thing I would say is that operative DM was served 3 times, and in one of those times, he was with another operative as well. So that's the double violation that was talked about at India House. I just would also add that at 8 establishments, he was carded. So it's not like he went places and people didn't recognize that he could be a young man. And further, just regarding the underage operatives that we get, we don't see them beforehand. We work with Northampton Prevention Coalition, and they reach out to various places to get them. I don't even know where they get them, but they organize it, and we just go as the people to monitor and kind of run it, but they get the operatives. So I certainly wouldn't want anyone to think that we were intentionally trying to trip anyone up. Our goal is to have 100% compliance. We don't want to catch people doing anything wrong. We want to catch them doing it right. So we, you know, the minors show up that evening, and then We use them. We don't modify them. You know, our policy indicates not to modify them. Certainly, we would never do anything like that. We don't want to trick anybody. It's certainly not our intent. So I just thought that's important to say.
And to Attorney McGuire's attention that your operative left the bar with beer?
Yes, they're directed to get a receipt from the establishment. And when the operative came out, he indicated to us, to the officer, that he asked for a receipt and he was denied. So he was worried that without the receipt, he wouldn't be able to get any evidence. So he carried the beer out from that establishment and turned it over immediately to the officer. Because he had been told to get a receipt, so he didn't know what else to do, and that's the decision that he made. He was instructed right after he did it, like we told you not to do that. So certainly he did do that. No argument there. He brought it out. It was confiscated. At the end of the night, we gave him a breath test, and certainly it was zero. He hadn't consumed any of it, and that's the concern about carrying it out is that they may consume it. Certainly that wasn't done.
So this was the first time he had done this when he didn't get a receipt.
Right.
He thought he needed to bring you some evidence.
That's what he
thought.
He
didn't walk out without receipts.
Exactly.
I just didn't get a receipt, but I did get served.
First time it's ever happened when we've done these, but that's what happened.
Okay.
No, he said he was denied a receipt. He actually asked, and they said no. Sorry.
That's what he told the officer.
You're talking about the verbs. Paid with cash.
That's
I eat there a lot, and every time I do, I get a receipt. So I don't.
I wasn't there. I can only report what he told the officers, and that's what he told them as far as why he carried it out.
So how many? How many establishments did you go to all night? I noticed you said he was eight of them. He got carted out, right?
He got
so
carted out.
What was the total amount of places?
We did 98 checks that night.
Wow. Okay. So that's pretty good. Only seven for 98. That's pretty awesome.
But this is the first time you had worked with this fellow.
We've never worked with him before.
Okay. Was there anything else in what Mr. McGuire said or any of the other licensees said that you care to respond to?
No.
And is there anything that your officers have to add?
Do you have any questions for them, or if there's anything you guys
want to
add?
I have no particular questions, but.
I don't have anything else to add. I basically have the same thing that Captain Casper said as far as what actually happened at each establishment from the three violations that I oversaw. So,
okay. I'm sorry. Just tell the reporter what your name is.
Brendan McKay, police officer with Northampton.
Brendan.
Yes.
And if you wanted to ask anything further about the receipt, I believe it was Officer Salado that spoke with the minor when he came out, so he might be able to answer that more if there's something more you need to know about it.
Officer Salado, so he came out holding a bottle of Corona or something? And
yes, sir, he did.
And you just took it from him?
I did.
Okay.
It was eventually discarded.
Yeah, okay. You told him that that's not the way it works?
Yes. He informed me that he had tried to get a receipt. They weren't able to give him one for whatever reason.
Uh-huh.
And he brought the bottle of beer out with him. I informed him that was not within the guidelines of what was coming in here.
Okay. All right. Ryan Sutherland, right?
Anthony, sir.
Anthony, sorry.
That's okay.
Do you have any questions for us?
I don't.
Any questions for any of the other licensees? Thank you, officer.
Yeah.
Thank you, Captain.
Excuse me. Could I ask the officer one question?
Officer Sotolano?
Officer Sotolano.
Okay, go ahead.
It's my
understanding. Would you like me to stand there or next to you? Okay.
Oh, yeah. Well, go over here. It won't take but a minute. It's my understanding that you were in the cruiser at the time the Roberto's sting took place.
Yes.
You never went into Roberto's.
Not until after it served the...
Right, and that would have been like at 10:30.
Yes.
So you never, and no other police officer went inside.
No.
So you have no idea as to whether or not this operative was telling the truth when he said they refused him a receipt. Is that correct?
I have no way to confirm that, no.
You didn't see it yourself?
No.
Okay, thank you. That's all I have.
Is there any other comment from anyone in the audience about this matter? Okay. At this time, let me close the violation. Move to close the violation hearing.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I would like to present evidence.
Please proceed.
Okay. I want to call Jennifer Travato. I'll just stay over here. Okay. But could you tell the commission a bit about your educational background and what you do for work?
I'm Jennifer Travato. I was the bartender at Roberto's that night. I have a bachelor's degree from UMass in psychology and sociology. I've held two liquor licenses in my name in Chickadee and Springfield. Was general manager for Applebee's for 6 years and worked in restaurants my whole life. I've been tip certified. I'm served safe alcohol certified, so safe food and crowd.
And did you do anything at Applebee's in connection with training of people who have to serve drinks to?
Yeah, I oversaw the training program for new managers and for staff in regards to alcohol.
And what region did that cover?
New England.
The entire New England region. And how many years did you do that?
About six.
So you were on duty on the night of December 26th, is that correct? And what was your job there?
I'm the front house manager in the bartender.
Okay. And who else was working at the time?
Another bartender, Noreen, and the owner's son, Chris, was mostly in the back, but helping us.
Okay. Noreen Valenta.
Yes.
Okay. And at some point in time, did the gentleman, bearded gentleman, identified code name DM appear at your establishment? About what time was that?
Around 8:30.
Was DM alone or in the company of other people?
He was with a younger looking girl. They asked for a table. They were told it would be a few minutes wait. So they came and sat at the bar and I offered them menus. She said she'd just have a water for now and he got a Corona. Then she left.
And he remained there?
Yes.
And why did you serve him?
He looked over 30 to me.
Okay. And so, where were you standing at the time, or for most of the time, that DM was seated at the bar?
He sat about 10 feet from the door and right across from our register. Kind of a nice, easy in spot.
Okay, about in the middle?
Yeah.
But a little bit to the left as you're sitting?
Yeah.
Okay. And you were in his presence a foot or so away?
Yes.
Did you see him leave?
They were looking at a menu. I assumed they got sat at the table, and I looked up and he and his beer were gone. I assumed he brought it with him to the table in the dining room.
And give me an idea of the distance between where you were standing and the doorway that he used, or apparently used, the front door that he used to exit.
Maybe 10 feet.
Did he at any point in time, or anyone else, ask for a receipt?
No, they print automatically. When someone just gets a beer, usually they don't want one, so we just toss it to the side. But if he had asked, I could have printed him one in under 30 seconds.
And how would you print out the receipt?
I would just have to turn. I could touch the computer from where he was sitting, so it would have been really easy. He never asked me for one.
Have you ever, in your years working in this field, refused a request from a customer for a receipt?
No.
Did he ask for a receipt from any other staff member to the best of your knowledge?
That's it. Thank you.
Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah, I'm sorry. We do have a question for Mr. Mullen.
So I guess for the officers, I'd have a question. So is this gentleman DM, is Roberto's the first place that he went and he actually was able to buy? Because of the timeline, he was in three, so it must have been right because it was 8:25. So that was the first time.
I would have to refer to my report for the exact time frame of it.
Because I'm just trying to establish to his point. I think what I'm trying to say is, you didn't really know he was supposed to ask for a receipt until you went out when he went out with a beer and you say, no, that's not how it works.
We had gone over the parameters of what they were supposed to do before we went out on the road.
Yeah.
We'd spent considerable amount of time with all of them together, explaining to them what, you know, what sort of the tenets of the operation were supposed to be.
Okay. I don't have any other questions. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, is there anyone else who wants to speak to the matter of these alleged violations? All right, then I will move to close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
We'll now move to a discussion of whether violations occurred in these cases. I would start out by saying that that all of the licensees did in fact admit that an underage person got served. In most cases here, including the case of Bistro Le Gras, Fresh Pasta, Siam Square, and Sierra Grill, they did not involve the question of whether or not the operative who was sent in could be somehow found to be in violation of the guidelines governing such compliance checks. So I would like to, so they've admitted to the violation, have said that they wouldn't want it to happen again. So in the case of those establishments, I would say Bistro Le Gras, Fresh Pasta, Siam Square, and Sierra Grill, that we find that a violation did occur as outlined by the NPD. So I'd like to hear from you on that.
Well, I think it's admitted, so I don't know how else you could find it.
Okay, then I'll make a motion that a violation occurred of Chapter 138, Section 34, in these five cases, again, Bistro Le Gras, Fresh Pasta, Siam Square, Sierra Grill. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor of finding a violation? Aye. We will move to whatever sanction we may consider in a second here. Then I'd like to take the case of the Blue Bonnet, Roberto's, and Siam Square. In the case of Siam Square, India House, I apologize. India House has admitted that they also served the underage person. In this case, another person. There are two counts here. One for serving the person who appeared to look older, according to testimony of other licensees here, and one of serving somebody who was a young woman. So the owner has admitted to the violation in that case. So I would also move that there is one count in India House where the violation was clear and that we find him in violation of Chapter 138, Section 34. Motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, then moving to Roberto's, Blue Bonnet, and the second violation at India House, we have the picture and the testimony of Attorney McGuire, the bartender at Roberto's, the manager of Siam Square, and also the manager and the server at Blue Bonnet. So I'll let you tell me what you consider happened in these cases.
Well, I mean, he presented that there's two other cases here, and there's two points to be made, which, you know, I haven't had time to go through that. I don't know what those laws are. I'm not familiar with them. So, to me, I wouldn't be able
Well, I did read Mr. McGuire's memo. I actually looked at some of the things that he brought up here. And he, to me, appears to have a valid point. Mm-hmm. Based on the testimony of the Indian House and the group on it as well, this person, and you know, I'm looking at it myself personally, I could have made the same mistake. So
I agree.
Attorney McGuire has stipulated that the compliance check is valid only if you follow these guidelines. And in this case, although as the NPD has said, there's no intent to trick anybody. And the whole point of these compliance checks is just to keep everybody on their guard against underage service. In this case, although you know it wasn't with intent to deceive, this person, when the Prevention Coalition sent them to the NPD to be used for this sting, he does look like he's older, and it would appear to me that based on the cases that Attorney McGuire cited in the guidelines here, that this may not have been a valid compliance check using this operative. I am persuaded of that after hearing from everybody here. So you're thinking?
I agree. I would have to say that I would probably serve as well.
Yeah.
You know, again, I'm not clear on these. I'm going to read them later. Like you said, you read them, and Mr.
McGuire.
It's due diligence.
McGuire.
Sorry.
We're all white. We're all mixed.
I'm half Irish. All right, but again, his memo, and I assume, Captain Casper, did you get a copy of Attorney McGuire's memo prior
yes.
to this meeting?
Yes.
And you've had a chance to review it?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Is there anything, since we appear to be heading in the direction of relying on this here to make some sort of finding, do you have any reaction to any of the points that Attorney McGuire brought up in his memorandum?
No, I certainly understand his points, and as I said, it's not about trickery for us. My only concern is if you were to find that we had used someone that looked older, then in the future when we run these compliance checks, what kind of parameters are we putting in place for the future? I mean, the fact is, these places did serve to a 20-year-old, eight places carded it. So in the future, when I'm looking at how do I look at someone to know how old they look, you know, am I doing it by height or they have facial hair, we didn't modify them, he's 20. And that's why we run compliance checks, to make sure that 20-year-olds can't get alcohol, and in this case, he did. So that's concerning. I mean, are we sending a message that if you look older and you're 19 or 20, you're gonna get served? You know, and I that's not a message that we want to send, certainly. So that's my only concern, is if you were to find that way and say, we use someone that looked older, as far as how we run our compliance checks in the future, you know, how are we to do that and what parameters are we to use? That makes it a bit complicated. And then it seems that it opens the door for future cases that there'll be scrutiny for our minors to look at them and say, well, they look like they could be 25 or they look like they could be 22. That makes it a little more challenging for us.
I understand.
I have the same concerns. One second, Mr.
McCarthy.
I have the same concerns.
And, I'm sorry.
One second.
Sure.
You know, to the point, I wouldn't want you to have to sit and look in and say, you know, who are we going to use, who are we not, and then who makes that judgment call? The bottom line is, you're right. I guess everybody should be carded because no one should be served with a drink underage. But I don't know. I had another point, but it'll come back.
Well, I just say, you deserve a response, I guess, to this. I appreciate, you know, the dilemma that this might pose, but in this case, this person might be at the upper end of the range of anyone you ever might use for such checks. You know, I won't ask you to, you know, search through your memory for, you know, other cases where you might have had somebody quite so, you know, old looking. I mean, there is, there's certainly merit to what you say, but I think in this particular case, this may be an outlier and perhaps wouldn't matter in the future. And the guidelines, what licensees do is follow procedure if they look under 30, and that seems to allow certainly enough room. That was my thought upon hearing from them and looking at these photos. So thank you.
Yeah, 8 out of the 11 places he went into did think that he looked, that they carded him. And I think that that's compelling. You know, people looked at him and thought that. So much more than the majority, even though I know that we have a chalkboard and the time things, but even outside, he did go into 11 places and was only served at 3.
May I respond?
Briefly.
I haven't been brief. First of all, only 3 out of 11? That is an astoundingly high hit ratio, very high batting average. I don't know, we don't have any other statistics for the other participants, but we know that he was found, of the 7 violations found, he was in 3 of them. Second point is, the dilemma that the captain points out is not unique to the police department. It's the same dilemma that you two have tonight. And it's the same dilemma that Pete and Mo and Jen have at Roberto's. They have to exercise judgment. And what they do is they follow the guidelines. If the guidelines don't, if we want to change the law, then as you pointed out, Mr. Rosen, you know, you have to become a legislator if you want to change the law. And you could change the law to say, well, okay, overbribe, everyone gets carded. Everyone. It's a law. But that is not the law. The law is everyone has to follow these guidelines. And the question is, does that person reasonably look 20?
Thank you, Mr. Miller.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, we are, we appear to have entered the hearing phase of this again, but let me quickly exit again.
No, so, that was my point earlier was to be that this just goes to prove, you know, how hard this business is. Not only to identify people that are of age, but also to stop somebody from walking out of your establishment without a home. Like I said in a prior meeting, if I personally wanted to walk out of a building with alcohol, I could do it, you know, and I could probably do it 99% of the time, short of having somebody there to pat you down every time. So, you know, it's tough. It is a tough business. So, you know, I can see their point.
All right. So we are left with 3 alleged violations, 1 from India House, 1 from Roberto's, and 1 from the Blue Bonnet involving these points we've been discussing. Would you like to make a motion in this case? Do you have whether a violation occurred or not?
I mean, again, you know, clearly with these, I don't think I did enough due diligence on these to know enough to make a motion. So I would be leaning more towards what's been presented here, what your notion is, actually.
All right, well, I think I've signaled what I'm thinking here. I think that the 3 licensees in this case have made a compelling case that that this was a person who appears to have exceeded the appearance guideline in the guidelines for these compliance checks. And again, there's no intent to deceive here on the part of anybody. It just happened that this fellow here, as I mentioned before, is at the upper range of this. So I would find that in this case, although they served an underage person, since the compliance check appears to have not followed the guidelines in 1 point, I would find that no violation occurred. Do I hear a second?
Explain that into 1 point. What do you mean? Into 1 point?
The
no receipt factor.
No. That
that's not
That is not, yeah. We're not exceeding the bar. No, the only matter really before us is whether or not a violation of Chapter 138, Section 34 occurred, service of alcoholic beverage to an underage person. And although this was an underage person, because it was being run in connection with a compliance check, which are governed by certain guidelines and also are have been, these guidelines have been reviewed by courts, and there's case law regarding this. And again, Attorney McGuire has brought up that this, in this instance, one of the guidelines was not followed, and to give the benefit of the doubt to the licensee, I think in this case, would only be fair. So I am thinking that no violation occurred in those three cases. The one count at India House, the one count at Blue Bonnet, and the one count at Roberto's. I make a motion to that effect. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, we have found that violations of Chapter 138, Section 34, service of alcohol to minors have occurred in the case of India House, one count only, Bistro Le Gras, Viva Fresh Pasta, Siam Square, and Sierra Grill. I note that there have been no violations for underage service in the recent past or at any point in the past on these compliance checks from any of these licensees. So it has been our custom in these cases, and again, the point of the compliance checks, as the captain pointed out, is just to make sure that everybody's following it. If we find a violation, it's not our intention to provide a heavy sanction. The mere fact that these are going on, that there is, that a licensee may have been caught in this and in error, is just a matter of keeping the community safe. But we don't wish to apply, and we haven't wished to apply in the past, any heavy sanction in this case, barring any future violations. We think the message goes out. The message certainly goes out to people brought in on these violations that underage service of minors is something to watch very carefully. So in these cases, as we have done in the past, and as I propose we do now, I would move that we suspend the liquor license for one day, but the suspension to be suspended for 6 months barring any future violations. So we find that, yes, they were in violation in this case. They should serve a one-day revocation of their liquor license, but we suspend that suspension on good behavior for 6 months from this date. So that is my motion, a one-day suspension suspended for 6 months.
Is 6 months necessary, or can you go 3, 4?
It's been our custom to do 6 months.
And then I second that.
Okay, unless you want to persuade me that we should go something.
Well, I just saying more to your point.
Well, I mean, the aim is that, they never do it again.
True enough.
So is that a second?
I did think.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So is that clear then to the licensees? We found no violation in the case of Roberto's or Blue Bonnet. We found one violation in the case of India House. Any underage service to minors that's brought to us by the police department within the next 6 months and would be cause for us to reopen this violation and invoke the suspension that we suspended. Is that clear? Sorry, any questions on that? Okay. All right, then this matter is concluded. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Okay, could you, we have another matter. We've been going late, so we would like to move to the next item on the agenda, please. Thank you very much, all of you, for your patience.
Oh, good.
Okay, I would like to move to item number 6, and I would like to open a violation hearing for VAP Limited, doing business as Molino's Trattoria and Bishop's Lounge at 41 Strong Avenue. This is an all alcohol license, number 48. It is alleged by the police department that a violation occurred on December 4th, 2014. Before I get into that, something I failed to do opening the last hearing was just to swear in witnesses. Anyone who intends to speak to this matter, I would ask you to stand up at this time. Anyone intends to speak to the matter of the violation of Bishop's. Would you all raise your right hands and swear or affirm that you everything you say for this proceeding is true to the best of your knowledge?
Yes.
I do. Thank you. Okay. All right. So, Captain Casper.
My portion is very brief on this one. The officer that was there that night is going to speak more about the details, but in general, on December 4th, 2014, several of our officers were in the area on Strong Avenue outside doing a separate investigation. During that time, there was a violation of License Commission 2 a.m. rules allowing re-entry after 1 a.m. and failure to secure the door to prevent re-entry, and a second violation of MGL 138, Section 63, delay or hindering an authorized investigator or agent of local licensing authorities. So I'll have the officer speak to you for you.
Okay.
It's Officer Anthony Sedlato.
Officer,
please
proceed.
Would you just like a brief overview of?
Yeah, tell us what you think we need to know in order to render a judgment on this.
As Captain Casper said, Thursday, December 4th, 1:20 in the morning, Sergeant Golick and I were conducting an investigation in front of Bishop's Lounge. It had been reported to us that a couple days prior there had been a fight that had spilled out into the street and a male had brandished a handgun and had made some threats to shoot somebody that was involved in the fight. A description was given to us of that male. Sergeant Golick and I proceeded to the area. We located a male matching that description in front of the bar. He was standing outside smoking a cigarette. Sergeant Golick and I approached the male with the intention to speak to him about the incident. I tried to engage him in conversation. As I began speaking to him, the doorman who was in front of, was holding the door open at Bishop's Lounge, interrupted my conversation and said, "Hey, he doesn't need to answer any of your questions." I informed the doorman that the matter didn't involve him, that he needed to mind his business. Continued to try to speak with the male. The male declined to speak with us. At that point, our investigation was closed. As we went to leave, I noticed that the doorman was holding the door open by leaning against it. As I'm sure you're probably aware, Bishop's is a three-story building. The bottom of the stairs is the main entrance with a door. He was standing at the top of the stairs holding the door open. I informed him that he needed to close the door. It was after 1 o'clock in the morning. Per Northampton Liquor Commission rules, door needs to be closed and locked after 1 a.m. He flatly replied to me, "No, I don't. I'm letting people in and out." I told him again that he needed to close the door. He declined. At that point, I demanded his name. He gave me his information. I returned to my cruiser, continued to observe the area. I noticed that he walked away from the door. The door automatically shut on its own, but the door was unlocked, thus allowing the free flow of traffic, contrary to regulations, obviously. It's been my experience, I've been a police officer here going into my fifth year, it's been my experience that door is customarily locked. There are no other businesses in that building that are open at that hour for patronage. Everyone in the building is typically at Bishop's Lounge, and obviously leaves between 1 and 2 a.m.
Did you speak to, I see that Nicole Laraway was the manager in charge?
I believe she was the manager on duty at the time. I did not speak with her directly. I spoke with Mr. Paul Atoll, excuse me if I'm mispronouncing that.
Right. When did you speak to Mr. Polito?
A couple weeks later. As I had stated, we had sort of had a tandem investigation going into the report of the mail that had gone outside of the bar.
Okay. Do you have questions for Christina?
So when you asked him to shut the door, because it was past the time, he actually, what did he say to you?
He was, I remember distinctly, he was smoking a cigarette outside. He flatly said to me, very matter-of-factly, no, I don't, I'm letting people in and out.
I don't know why anybody would, you guys are there to help. I don't know why anybody would ever speak to you guys.
I'm not sure, sir.
I don't know. So, all right.
I don't think interfering, when he interfered with the police investigation, the guy you were tracking. And
we were attempting to have a separate conversation with him, and he interjected and said,
That's a piece of the events that we probably can't address here. We just need to know whether or not the 2 a.m. rules were there, and also we would take note of the employee's demeanor with the enforcement agency, the MPD. So you left the place. You didn't speak to the manager in charge, and you just noted, made the report,
yes,
and brought the violation.
Yes, and I received the information about the manager and the other required information a couple of weeks later.
So you, and then you spoke to Mr. Polito after that.
Yes.
Okay. Does the department have anything further to add on this? Thank you all, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Polito, do you have anybody else or just yourself to speak to this?
Well, actually, I have Sean Parker O'Grady, that bought, he was the phone. Okay.
Could you identify yourself?
Yep, my name is Walton Polito, owner of Polito's Ambitions Lounge. And like I said, I have Sean here, that he was the tour guide that night when that supposed incident took place. So maybe before I say anything more, maybe you can testify.
As you wish.
Yeah.
Again, identify yourself.
My name is Sean Parker Reed. I was on duty as the doorman that night doing security, which I had been working there probably about a month when this came up. So I know not to let anyone in after 1 o'clock. I go down there, 3 flights of stairs, at 1 o'clock, to lock the door. I noticed that the police, there was 2 officers outside interacting with somebody. So I, recent law school graduate, peeked my head out to see what was going on and noticed that they were questioning a man who, with the type of questions that were being asked as a due process of law, didn't need to answer their questions. I said it once, just aloud. And then that's when they snapped and took my information. It was not later, it was right then and there, at the moment that I interjected, just trying to make sure the lost future lawyer, hopefully, knock on wood, passed the bar in July, that the law was followed. So I was standing at this the door, right here, when I was then subsequently notified to secure the door and lock it. I stayed outside and closed the door so people who were leaving would have to get through me, and thus nobody could get in without having to get through me, becoming the door, even when it was open, standing in the doorway on the stairs to Bishop's as a door if it were open. And that's all I have to say to clear it up and everything, is that my info was asked for immediately the second I notified.
You stayed there until the entire building was empty?
No. I stayed down there at the door, yes.
Right, but then you went back.
I'm either inside in front of the door, just like this, or I'm right inside, and there's a second doorman security that is upstairs at that time.
The officer has alleged that you said you're letting people in and out.
Which is ridiculous, I'm sorry. But I've been doing this job for a month. I know I have, like, 2 requirements. I ID everybody. If there's a band, I take $5 at 1 o'clock. I make sure nobody leaves with a drink, and nobody gets in. I've had to call the police before this incident for a rowdy customer that was trying to basically break back in the building after 1 o'clock. It's not the first time. And it's just absurd to me that I would let somebody in while there's officers in front of me.
So you're familiar with the details of the 1 a.m. closing laws in Northampton?
Yeah.
So, no, it was the,
That's the reason I go down. That's the reason I was there, is because I go down the three flights of steps at around 10:00, stand there, and at 1 o'clock, on the dot, click, connect, lock it up.
And you know, we require establishments also to post the special 1 a.m. rules.
It is. It's right next to the door.
2 a.m.
rules.
Right. It's right next to that door?
There's a door and a little
The door has a little window right next to it, but a kind of glass window, it's right there. So you can't sit in, it's just two steps.
Okay.
So it was odd to us too that, this charges was against us. Again, I just want to clear something. Maybe we can ask the officer, was anybody walked inside through those doors at the time he was there? I wasn't kind of clear on that.
We can pose that question to the officer.
Okay, so I wasn't clear on that, but it's just like, the police has been in our building millions of times. They know who worked there. They know where Bishop's is. They know in and outside, everything about that place. I mean, they even said it themselves that they even checked the door to make sure it's locked every time they pass by. I don't see why, any of us will. We have full respect to police department and we cooperate in any event. And when they were investigating about the incident that happened at Bishop's, well, not at Bishop's, but outside, that week, they were here, they were in my office actually, trying to get a video footage of our video cameras. If that took place, I would assume that somebody would have told me something, hey, listen, we were here, we had that kind of reaction. You better check on your cameras and see what was going on. Nothing was said to us, nothing was said to me, and they were, like I said, they were there a whole week trying to get a footage off our video camera. And that person that they were questioning, the reason he was outside of the building, they caught him outside of the building, because we as a bar trespassed. The incident was that there was some sort of drama happened at Bishop's. Our door guys escorted these kids outside. Outside, they continued to have some sort of brawl or something, some sort of word fight, and somebody supposedly pulled out a gun. And so I didn't see it, but whoever saw the gun, we called the police right away to make sure that this kid gets caught. And that
when was that? That was the same
That night. Was Monday. So this incident happened on Wednesday, right? December 4th? Wednesday.
4th.
So the prior incident that they were investigating about, that happened Monday night. So, and the Wednesday, that kid came back to our establishment, and we were like, look, you need to leave until we figure out exactly what's going on. So we actually escorted him out. We actually trespassed him from the bar. That's why he was standing in front of the bar outside the building. On Wednesday.
So he I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, go ahead.
So he came to the bar on Wednesday.
Correct.
After the incident on Monday.
Correct.
You said you're trespassing because we got you on our list, which
right.
of course
Correct.
Is something you should
yeah.
do.
Yeah.
Did you know Mr.
No.
No, he didn't.
I wasn't working on Monday.
Okay. So you did this individual wasn't known to you as somebody who'd been trespassed already by Bishop's.
Correct.
I did not know until
okay. So but he didn't get in to Bishop's
no,
that night?
No, well he got in and we kinda escorted him out, so he was standing in front of the building.
Not you, somebody
no,
else.
No.
Somebody
the
else.
Person, the person that did the incident on Monday.
Right.
He came back into Bishop's. So we were like, look, until we figure out what's going on, supposedly you had a gun outside or whatever. There's an investigation going on with the police department, so you need to not come to Bishop's, you know what I mean? So we escorted him out. So he was standing in front of the building outside, smoking a cigarette. That's when the police officers came upon him, I guess.
And did you see him escorted out by your colleagues at the bar?
Yes.
And did they tell you why he was being shown out
I
the door?
I just heard that there was an incident.
Okay.
And so
then,
then the police
when the police showed up and started to talk to him, you inserted yourself into the conversation between the police officer and this person who'd been trespassed from your bar.
I inserted myself into the conversation as not a doorman, just as my lawyer instincts. The questions they were asking him were interrogation type questions, and I just didn't want a person, an individual, to be ignorant of their rights at that moment. And
right.
So I told him he did not need to answer these officers' questions.
Okay.
Because legally he didn't. And I guess maybe it's my own fault. I shouldn't have butted my head where it didn't matter. It's just future young lawyer, idealistic.
So you said when you interjected, they snapped at you and asked for
snapped
your
information. Asked me my name, what I did.
And then your response was, nope, I'm going to stand right here.
I gave them my name and title and everything.
And then
if I responded anything to them, it was that I was letting people out. Because letting people in is the opposite of my job.
Is it a possibility that you would have, after what had just ensued, because that's not happening on a normal night, that possibly you're kind of like, oh, and walked away and forgot to lock the door?
No,
because the officer also testified that he said he observed for a while and people were still coming in and out. Or is it when somebody comes over and opens the door, then somebody has an opportunity to go in?
And that's why I was standing in the doorway, so nobody could come in and people...
Oh, so you didn't go upstairs?
Yeah,
well,
and
people
do.
I
was
no, they
don't,
they don't leave the front door until the bartenders come and tell them to leave.
Yeah.
So once 2 o'clock everybody gets out, the bartender comes down and said, okay, we're done. So that's when they kind of... By that time, everybody's pretty much out and over with anyway. It's like 2:30, so like, then they go back up to Bishop's to help clean up and stuff. And only after that, the only people go in and out of building is the band members that are trying to unload or something.
You're off the premises, though, by 2:45 in that case, correct?
Yes. Well, sometimes it goes to 3, but yeah. But I mean, like I said, we, you know, fully cooperate with the police department in and out every day. You know, they were there throughout the whole week trying to get a video surveillance about the kid with a gun. And nothing was said. And, you know, on the last time I was here with other charges, if you remember, I told you guys I was overseas vacationing. And I knew the next day what happened. The next day. This time, I opened my email last week. And I was looking at the agenda because I knew that there was all the 7 restaurants stuff was going on. And I looked at it, and my name was up there. I didn't even know.
We sent certified notices of violation here.
Never got it. So.
His card never came back, which is why I sent the email earlier than I usually do. But Sean's did get
mine
there.
Arrived
sent
only
to the restaurant.
Early last week.
Well, that's sufficient time. As long as you had it.
Yeah, I know. The other day, 7 days or whatever.
It never came back to the house.
No.
7 days.
But you got the notice.
It may not have been 7 days, but yes.
I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say, bottom line, I'm here right now, but thank God I opened the email, but what I'm trying to say is, if I knew that this took place week after, or like I said, they were there the whole week, I could have literally pulled it up from the camera system and see exactly what happened. We have cameras watching the whole main door.
So why can't you still do that?
Because it has a three-week loop. It's been 2 months.
You're saying you found out after the fact after it was 3 weeks over?
I found out last week that this was the this was the charges. I didn't even know.
Digital or video?
What, the camera?
To my point, I have a 9-month loop, so
I mean,
a security system, so I'm sure they make all different kinds, but.
Oh, yeah, I don't know why it writes over, but it writes over after three. I mean, maybe if I call the camera company, maybe they can pull it up.
Is it digital? You might be able to. I don't know.
I have no idea.
It's not helping you. I mean, if you could get the video, or, that would
be great. Trust me, I want to get the video. But it's still like video or not. I mean, it doesn't make sense that we're going to just snap at a police officer and just, like, front of their faces, let people in and out. It just doesn't make sense. We're not that kind of people, I mean.
Yeah.
Did the Officer Salvato said that he spoke to you a couple of weeks
later? I saw him. He came to me asking for information about the Nicole, one of the bartenders that works for me, that's all.
She was the one in charge on that night?
No, she was not.
Okay.
She was bartending on Monday night, the incident that they were investigating.
I see.
So that's why he came here.
Who was in charge on the night of this violation?
Jay. Who was Jay Macier?
Okay.
We have Nicole's name, the person in charge of the business.
Right, I know. So Nicole Laraway was not in charge the night of the violation, the alleged violation. But who was?
Jane Macier.
Yeah, Jane Macier.
But I don't think Jane knew about this, was it?
All right, let me, if you could step aside for one second.
Yeah.
And could I ask Captain Casper and Officer Sotolato a couple questions here? The licensee has said that you didn't get the notice of this. I don't know what happened there. But you didn't speak to him about this incident, about the violation you're alleging here, about the reentry matter. You didn't speak to him 2 weeks later about that particular thing?
As I said, I had two things going on, sort of the guy with the gun and this. Maybe that was a communication oversight on my part.
So you did not tell Mr. Altall about your doorman gave me lip that was letting people in and out?
No, I didn't.
Okay. And you didn't speak to Ms. Laraway on that night?
No.
And you didn't speak to Mr. Macier, who apparently was actually the one in charge on that night. Your report says this, but the licensee has said there was somebody else.
Yes, that's an oversight on my part.
Okay. But Nicole Laraway, again, this matter, we're not so much concerned with. She was in charge the night of the gun brandishing incident.
And, you know, if I could just offer, you know, sort of pairing off what Mr. Politol said with regard to his cooperation with the police and everything else. The incident that was originally reported to us while we were in front of the bar was that there had been a fight inside the bar that spilled outside, somebody had brandished a handgun, etc. The person who reported this to Sergeant Golick and I came into the police station lobby and said that he was concerned about reporting this to the police because of the atmosphere at Bishop's Lounge with their disdain sort of towards the police. And that's exactly what was expressed to me with Mr. Parker O'Grady when we were interacting in front of the bar. He didn't display any sort of attitude towards cooperation with the police or the licensing authority. Sergeant Golick was present when he said to me, very flat out, I'm letting people in and out. I don't need to close the door. It wasn't as if it was offered in passing or if I misunderstood it. It was very clear to me.
Mr. Paul Thomas asked us to ask you, did anybody go in and out while you were standing there?
I did not observe anybody going in or out. Like I said, I noticed that the door was unlocked and it's been my pass.
So nobody, as far as you know, was admitted after 1 a.m. while you or Sergeant Golick was there?
Not that I saw, no.
I see.
As I said, the door was unlocked. It has been my past experience that the door is commonly locked, but on this occasion it was unlocked.
Okay, so we don't know, in fact, that... But he was standing there at the time, and you say that you say in your report the door to the bar was open and people were allowed to walk in and out, but now you're saying that nobody walked in. We don't care if people walk out.
I didn't observe anybody walk in. If somebody had wanted to walk in, they could have. I didn't firsthand observe somebody walk in.
But if he's standing in front of the door, if the door is open, and sometimes, as far as we're concerned, we've had previous discussions about this point. I mean, if you got staff at the door is secure.
Okay. The door, as I said, he was holding the door open. The pathway through the doorway was clear. He would have had to take some sort of action to stop somebody from walking through the doorway.
But nobody walked through the door.
No.
Yeah. So I mean, he had opportunity to say, "Hey, no, you can't come in. We're done."
I suppose he could have had that. Okay. Had that happened, yes.
So, besides that, was there any other violation? And you're very familiar, I know, with the 2 a.m. closing rules. Any other violation you're alleging here at the 2 a.m. closing rules? Nobody got entrance. He was at the door. Is there anything else about our special 2 a.m. closing rules you think that the establishment violated?
I would say his failure to comply with an order from the licensing authority, a representative of the licensing authority.
What was the order?
I informed him that he needed to close the door. It was after 1 a.m. and the door needs to be locked and secured. I was unaware that there's, you know, special provisions for if a staff member is holding the door open.
It's not a special provision. I don't know.
An understanding from you two gentlemen, excuse me.
If when these rules were hashed out, they said, you know, basically nobody gets in and out. So what do you do to keep people from getting out? You secure the door, but it doesn't mean that the door has to be physically locked. If somebody's standing there, if the door is open for air, and this is, you know, the case in the warmer months sometimes, people walk out, they don't get back in. If a guy is, a bouncer is standing there, we wouldn't find a violation just because the door wasn't shut and locked.
Okay. Well,
the door was secured.
That's,
I mean,
a new...
Captain Counselor, I don't think you've been here for any of these previous dust-ups about these rules, have you?
I have not.
I recall discussions where this point came up, so if you're looking at a place and saying, are they keeping people from coming reentry after 1 a.m.? This guy's standing at the door, they are.
That's news to me, and I certainly will, you know, make the appropriate changes, but
yeah,
when I was hired here, I was trained that the door needs to be closed and locked. That's the rule.
Well, you know, if there's nobody there, yeah. Is this, Captain Casper, is this anything, is this news to you too?
It's not news to me. I think this violation allegation came more out of the fact that the gentleman told the officer, I'm letting people in and out. I think it was kind of all totality of the circumstances. The door was unlocked even though he was there, but then he was saying, I'm letting people in and out, and Officer Salata knew it was after 1 a.m. So I think that was at the crux of the violation.
I see. So he said that, but nobody actually came in when we were there. Sergeant Golick? Identify yourself.
I'm Sergeant Joseph Golick. I was with Officer Sotolato that night. We were down there investigating what was alleged to us a pretty serious criminal matter. We were speaking with someone, and Mr. Parker O'Grady was standing there. I wouldn't at all call our conversation with this male concerning or interrogation. There was no rights violated at all. It was a casual encounter on a sidewalk. We're both very well trained and know what we're doing as far as speaking with people. He interjected. I don't know why. It was, he doesn't need to answer your questions from behind us. So we're like, okay. So he started talking. During this whole thing, I wasn't focused on if anyone was coming in or out of the door. I was focused on our investigation, which that's what we should be focusing on. Instead, he drew our attention to interject in this. I don't know why he did that, but I didn't see.
Okay, leaving aside his, getting into lawyer mode there, which doesn't concern us here.
Mm-hmm.
Did you hear him say, I'm letting people in?
He said, as Officer Solado said, he said, I don't have to close the door, I'm letting people in and out. That was
in
his
and,
quote, unquote. Yes.
He said that.
Yes.
Was he aware of the time? Or did you then tell him? Did you tell him after that?
I told him.
It's past the time.
Once our discussion ended with the guy in the street,
so at first,
I told him he needed to shut the doors after 1 a.m.
So
that's what he said.
Yeah, so probably. Possible he wasn't aware of what time it was or whatever. I mean, he was more concerned in doing your job, I suppose.
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Sergeant. Does the licensee have anything else to add on this matter? Do you have any other questions for the licensee?
Before we do not even disrespect the police, I never have a record of that. And every time I'm here for any kind of charge, without even seeing any single evidence, by just taking their word, I accept the charge and I take responsibility. I think I prove that to you folks.
Okay.
And I just don't see why, you know, anybody would disrespect them. Like, it just doesn't make sense to me.
Okay.
Maybe he did say the part, you know, maybe he shouldn't have said that, but obviously not because nobody was let back into the building.
Well, and how long have you known Sean?
Excuse me.
I'm an attorney also, Cheryl Parker, but I happen to be his mother. And I know he's known him forever.
I'm sorry, you'll have to.
Can I just say that I'm sorry that if my big mouth got in the way and is interfering with him because I was overstepping my duties as a doorman, and if I did say I'm letting people in and out, it was a brain fart because the reason I'm there is to not let people in and to let people out, which is what I believe is what I said to the officer, and then he construed in and out when all I might have said is I'm letting people out, which is the reason I go down all three flights of stairs.
Yeah, maybe that happened.
At 1 o'clock.
Okay.
So I knew what time it was. That's
bottom line, we're not here to disrespect any police or any kind of investigation. And we're the one, by the way, we're the one who called the police for that investigation. We're the one, we were like, you know, I didn't have to. I could have said, you know what, whatever. I'm the one who was like, you know, get that kid off the streets. I'm the one who called them, guys, come here, look at the footage. If this kid is really carrying a gun like people said that he was, get him out.
I don't think we're questioning whether or not you support the police or not. And bottom line, in my opinion, you know, the police department's here to help.
Absolutely.
And be there.
Yeah.
You know, so especially when you call them down and say, man with a gun, and they're doing their job, and then to have one of your employees step in, whether he thinks it's right, wrong, or indifferent, they're in an investigation. They're doing their job.
Well, like I said,
so then when they notice that there's a door open and he thinks policy is that it should be shut, and then he informed them at 1 o'clock. You know, I mean, regardless. So there shouldn't be the way I was brought up is yes, sir, no, sir, whatever I can do to help, sir. And I'm sure that's how you are too, because that's what you just said. You actually, you know, are all about, you know, supporting the police department. So we get your point.
Okay.
You know, that you're there for it, so.
Before we get to the violation, this is not part of the violation. It's not really part of our thing, but it really, we do need, the police are there doing things, especially a guy with a gun. You've admitted to an error in judgment here. Don't do anything like that. Tell all your other employees, don't do anything like that.
Oh, absolutely.
Please let the police do their jobs, okay? And you weren't this guy's attorney, and you have no idea what was going on that thing, and that particular incident when that guy was there talking to the police officers. That was completely uncalled for, and not a matter under our jurisdiction, but, you know, we depend on the police to keep this community safe, and we can't have anybody interfering with that, and you've admitted this, but just repeat it again. You were really out of line doing that, and this whole train of things came from that, and we can't have that, okay? Anybody comes to a licensed establishment has to give the police their 100% cooperation. So, anyway, we need to talk about the violation now, though, the alleged violation. Do you want to make a motion?
I mean, I think
make a motion.
I'm going to make a motion that there was no violation. That there was just observance of the door open, so it was a mistake in judgment at this point.
All right, well, there's a motion.
Motion is that there's no violation.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Okay. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And just to explain why we voted, nobody came in. There was no violation of the 1 a.m. closing. It appears the door was secured. You know, again, I appreciate bringing this to our attention.
Can I request something from the police department, for one of you guys? That if something like this happens again, can they let us know right away so we can do our own investigation too?
Why don't you talk to Casper, Sergeant Golick, the officer.
Can I?
To Chief Sinkowitz. You work out whatever communication protocol you want, and I would urge you to do that. That would be great. Certainly would avoid any unpleasantness like this again.
Okay.
And I would just say, you know, and I don't know if I'm out of my jurisdiction, but whatever your policies are, you know, written or verbalized, maybe they should be known 100% through, you know, from the top to the bottom of every employee. You know, if one of your policies is to respect the police department, that should be reiterated.
Please go back and we don't want to hear any complaints from the police that they're having, as Officer Sotolano said, a hard time dealing with your establishment.
Thanks.
Thank you. Next on our agenda. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. It'll just take me
okay,
a
we have,
and I'll be very
Cindy
quiet.
Has all the name spellings and all that.
Is that something you can give me? Anyone email me?
I think I forwarded you the...
Oh, you did. You forwarded me a ton of stuff. Is this what you're talking about?
Yep, it's on there.
We had
yep.
Indians.
Restaurant names are in there.
We had Siamese.
If not, you
we
have my
Turks.
Email. I'll talk to you. I'll be around tomorrow. Okay?
But I mean, all those names. I understand her problem.
Okay,
item number 12. Vote on season liquor license renewals contingent upon inspection receipt of all paperwork. The fire department was here saying that they have a couple of issues.
These are the seasonal ones, but these are the ones that I send the renewals out on March 1st, and I just wanted to get your approval for once I get all the paperwork in, I can hand them their licenses rather than having to mail them out. Okay.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Approval of minutes from January 7th meeting. I didn't have a chance to look at them.
I didn't get
off. All right, do we have any new business? Okay, move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
What time is it?